Well, Steve and Ivor, thank you so much for your time today. This is an awesome thing, the Great Australian Songbook. Tell me how you were first approached to be on it. Steve, first?
I just got an email from Murray Tom, and he said, we've released this book in New Zealand, it's been very successful, and we'd really like to have Under the Milky Way on it. And I thought, it made kind of good sense. So I was in right from the word go.
And you were happy with the choice of song?
I thought Under the Milky Way is kind of like, has accidentally become a great Australian song. It's like, I thought it was very appropriate.
Did you know that when you wrote it?
No. It's very hard when you're writing a song, you don't sort of have all these, it's a bit like sort of having a tiny baby in your hands going, one day, this baby will be a prime minister. It's like, no, I didn't think that. It's sort of, and at first it was just another single, and it kind of, over the years, different people did it, and it sort of was accumulating meaning, was accumulating Australianness like a snowball running down a hill. Because then Jimmy Little did it, so that gave it a whole new thing, and then it was used in the Commonwealth Games and blah, 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 and all these films. So it sort of built up this, it's built up this very Australian thing that it never really, it was a very modest little song that just fell out one day.
Great Southern Land had to be on this album. Ivor, were you pleased when you got the call?
Oh, very. And that song, I can understand, as a songwriter, nothing is really planned. And there wasn't a great mission in my mind to write a song about Australia, and certainly had no inkling that it would still be here after 30 years. But I did have that moment when I was flying across Australia on the very first big tour that we went overseas for, and it was that light bulb moment where I realised the scale. It was all about scale to me, so it was a great thing that I was invited to have the song included, yeah.
So Great Southern Land was your song that had to be on this album, no question, it belongs, doesn't it?
Well, yes, and it's a great honour to be included in it. It's odd because when you're writing songs, you don't plan anything. I certainly had no idea when I wrote that first song for the next album. That's what I was doing, was writing songs for the next album. Had no idea that in 30 years it'd still be here. It was completely unplanned, and certainly a great surprise when I took it to the record company and the managers. Everybody reacted straight away, and I still haven't got it.
Well, what are some of the biggest adventures this song's taken on?
Oh, extraordinary things. I guess probably the 25-minute piece I made out of it for the Millennium. And that, of all the places in the world to be, on the forecourt of the Opera House, playing with the Sydney Symphony and Richard Tognetti and Ty Koz, in the 25 minutes leading up to the 10-second countdown, I stepped off stage, the Lord Mayor Frank Sartor gave me a glass of champagne, and fireworks went off over my head.
Good Lord. It was all downhill from there on in.
And it went out to 4 billion people on television, which was incredible. Oh, it's some best not to think about those things, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I was watching telly that night having a pizza.
Under the Milky Way has taken you on some adventures, though, too.
Yeah, I guess it has. I've battled with it, tried different versions, not playing it. Whatever I do, if I play it, there's people in the audience go, oh, no, he's playing it. If I don't play it, there's people go, you didn't play Under the Milky Way. So it's become a bit of a kind of a conundrum, exactly what to do with it, because I never imagined that I was going to have a song that stuck out above all the others. The sound of their breath fades with the light. I think about the loveless fascination. And as I say, now it's kind of got all this, it's got all this accretion. Like, it's a bit like the Bible. It starts off very simple, and then as it goes on and on and on, it has more and more. And now it's sort of people vote for it as their favourite song. I can't believe that it really is, but what it's become for people who don't have a favourite song, they go, oh, that'll be my favourite song. So it's sort of picked up that, it's like the donkey vote for favourite songs, you know what I mean?
We're sitting in a pub in the middle of the day, which is a very cool rock and roll thing to be doing. And certainly for CD 1 of this songbook, which is Last Century, can you believe? Mm-hmm. They've called it Last Century. That's a bit harsh. Most of these songs and your bands were playing in pubs. That's how you started, that's how you got your songs out there and so forth. The this century ones, not so much. How important was playing in pubs and getting your songs heard and getting them out there?
As a period, I think we were incredibly lucky because 20-year-olds during that period, that's what they did. There were no other distractions apparently because everybody went to bands to see pubs. And that not only created instant audience for the bands that existed, but it created other bands, it created crew people, it created just an incredible activity. And I remember, for example, going to, on our first tour to England, and arriving in London and being there at night with our bass player Keith, and we'd read New Music Express and Melody Maker for years and thought, right, we're finally in London, let's go and see a band. And we couldn't find anywhere to go in London. And we looked at each other and went, if we were in Sydney or Melbourne tonight, there'd be 50 great bands to go and see. So we were very lucky that that whole pub thing existed, I think.
I'll tell you what pub rock did for me. I turned up to a gig supporting the Flowers, and I wasn't allowed in the dressing room because Ivor was having a sleep. That's what pub rock did for me, all right?
That sounds quite right, actually.
In Corrimal. And the roadie's name was Marcus Schultz. And he said, I can't let you in there. Ivor's having a sleep. And I got changed in this kind of part next to the stage, which had all these, or the whole band had all these kind of electrical conductors, like something out of an old sci-fi movie, when they reanimate the corpse. But Ivor, was that a nice sleep?
That was a good sleep. Okay. Thank you for that.
That's pub rock to me.
Didn't you have another occasion where you were supporting them?
Oh, another time. I've got so many Ice House stories. We're playing at the Theberden Town Hall, and we were opening for Ice House, and a girl stood in front of me all night long. She'd been about 14 or 15 going, I hate you. Wishing that I would break a string or on my vocal cords.
She was an Ivor fan.
She was an Ivor fan, but it was like being a fullback down the other ends, down Hawthorne side when you're in Collingwood. And they go, that was like the front row. It wasn't like, they weren't there to listen to us. They wanted Ivor. We were a blight on the musical landscape to stand between them and Ivor. They didn't want not one another.
You did well. I wouldn't have coped.
What do you do?
I don't know what you're talking.
What do you do? Oh, could the girl at the front stop saying she hates me, please?
It'd be a very difficult thing to ignore, don't you think? You know, I don't know.
But you never had anything like that?
I can't recall. It's lucky I don't see very well, so that's probably a good thing. Yeah.
Now, I want to know, do you have a favourite song by someone else on this?
You know what, most of the songs on there I really love. I have to say, I'm not just saying this, I love that whole album, Primitive Man. I think Great Southern Land is an amazing song because it's like a film and it starts off, the focus is like the Australia, down the city in the rainy day, down in the harbour, and you imagine that. You can see Ivor standing down there at the quay and then suddenly it zooms right out. And you've kind of got the weirdness of the great southern land, burn you black. And so the song is taking us between the two Australias. And there is really only two Australias. There's the sort of intensity of the urban life, or there's that wild outback out there that we don't know about, but we know there's some weird stuff, and we know if white man goes out there, it's going to be kind of like some strange stuff's going to happen. That's why I think that's an amazing song. Otherwise, I reckon that song could have gone so badly wrong, Great Southern Land, but I really honestly think Ivor's pulled it off. And that is definitely one of the best Australian songs on there. But some of the others, I mean, Eagle Rock and Throw Your Arms Around Me, they're just so Australian. They're like, it's like you're back there under the Southern Cross and saluting the flag and Malcolm Fraser's, you know what I mean? It's all comes back, doesn't it?
There is history, and it's, thank you for that, by the way. That's, this is a true story. This is, you know how you have those days when you get a song in your head and this has happened with Under the Milky Way quite a lot this year, so completely distinct from this book. I think it's one of the marks of, there's a lot of songs like that on this collection that just will stick there, but the one for me, because we started off as a covers band, And we wanted to include a whole lot of Australian stuff, so we played songs by the Loved Ones. But we had played probably about four or five or six maybe songs by the Easy Beats. And the one we religiously, right from the outset, said we are never even going to attempt to play this song was Friday On My Mind, because it is, apart from being a fantastic song, it's incredibly complex,
incredibly
interesting piece of music composition. The guitar parts alone could keep music students busy for years taking them apart. They're incredible. So I have, that song for me is way up the top of the list.
Can I also say, just on a group that who I reckon never get the guitar recognition, is Skyhooks. Mm. And when Skyhooks first came out, visually they were a shock, what they were singing about, but the guitar interplay between Bongo and Red Simons, quite extraordinary and quite, it wasn't, Australia back in the 70s was on, and another guy going, and suddenly there was a band where there were two guitarists like working together, building up a picture, and like not only looking amazing, but having really very revolutionary, and the way the bass guitar fits in. So I reckon Skyhooks are a real, living in the 70s is a really great example of Australiana there.
You were giving us a few bars before of Mondo Rock.
Yeah, do you want to hear a bit?
Yes.
It was a party night. She was much older than. It was the first time. Come, said the boy. I mean, it's such a sexy song, isn't it?
Very.
Gee, I wish I had my virginity to lose all over again down at Bronte Beach. I'd get a paddle pop first, though.
Now the controversy. There are a few songs missing here, aren't there?
Definitely.
Inevitably, look, there is going to be... This is the kind of subject about which there is eternal debate. Mm-hmm. Because everybody... That's the wonderful thing about music, in fact. It's such an individual... There are very few things these days that become... ultimately very, very personal choices. Generally speaking, we're told quite a lot what we should buy and what we should like and so on. And that's the wonderful thing. So inevitably there is going to be your list of things that should have been on here. My list, it'll be different from my list of things that should have been on here as it will be for Steve's. But I think as a collection, this is a very good set of songs.
All right. You're willing to name a couple that might be missing, Steve?
I think, well, you know what, it never really occurred to me that there was anything missing until I walked in today and someone said it. But obviously I think Cattle and Cane by the Go-Betweens is quintessentially Australian and only could have come from Australia. I think you could have probably had a song by each of the Go-Betweens writers. Mm. I think you could have Spring Rain or Cattle and Cane, I think is really very Australian. Is there any, I can't think of any other glaring...
Solid Rock?
Yeah, Wide Open Road.
Is Wide Open Roads on there, isn't it?
Isn't Wide Open Road? Me now, it'll be on there, won't it?
No.
Don't know.
Wide Open Road, if it isn't on there, definitely should be there.
What about Sherbet?
And Sherbet.
Yeah, well, you see, there we go. This is going to go on now
what
for hours,
AC/DC?
Isn't it?
What about AC/DC?
Aren't they there?
Mm-mm. Long way to the top.
I guess we couldn't get their rights. Hang on, let me call someone at headquarters.
Well, This brings me to a question. Wasn't this put together by a New Zealander?
Uh-oh. Listen, we have come to praise this book,
indeed,
not to bury it.
I think that my understanding is anyway that there would have been a fairly large consulting process and it would have been a very difficult thing to do, I think. And inevitably, probably whoever is going to contribute to the compiling of this song has to stand back now and wait for people to throw at them, you should have put this on, you should have put that on. But once again, I'll defend it and say I think it's a great collection.
So it's nothing there you think shouldn't be there?
I think they're great. You know, my biases, for example, would go back to when Australian bands like the Easy Beats were really kind of taking on the world from a very long distance, which would have been a very difficult thing to do. But there's a great representation right through, right up to the present.
Steve, any of you think
I think they've all deserved their Guernsey, and I wouldn't be saying this if I didn't believe that wholeheartedly.
The other thing that's amazing about this is the actual book that comes with it. Things like the word, Garamel's put the words for his song and they're in Braille.
I know, that's incredible.
What did you contribute, Steve?
Me? I did a bit of a painting of Under the Milky Way. Surprise, surprise. And they liked it.
That's good.
Yeah.
And Ivor?
Well, I got the opportunity to sort of recount the story of how, in hindsight, why I arrived at that point of writing that song at that time, which it honestly didn't occur to me for 20 years or so that was the first thing I did after our very first international tour, and the first time I got incredibly homesick, and the first time I'd flown across Australia to get to London. It never dawned on me that was the first song I wrote when I got home. And so I just got to tell the story of that and write it down, and that was my little contribution.
It's lovely. It's something...
He didn't put nearly as much in as I did actually painting a picture, don't you think?
Absolutely, Steve, you win.
You win.
Yeah, you win.
At last.
Recognition.
After 31 years of not being allowed in that dressing room, finally the tables are turned.
It has been a big anniversary year for Ice House this year, hasn't it? You've been so busy.
It was the anniversary of the first album, but I guess probably marked by the change of name from Flowers to Ice House, which was a legal issue that we faced at that time. We had no choice, but it has been a big year, and for the first time we put together a compilation of all, you know, the 30 singles, and got all the interesting thing for me was to get together all the music videos, because I looked at it and thought, well, there are about 33 big budget videos here, and if you put that end to end, there's probably millions of dollars worth of money and effort that went into it with all the directors and all the people who worked on these things, and they've never been together in one place available. So that package was called White Heap, and it was great to put that together and incredible to see the way it was received.
It was indeed. Congratulations on that.
And thank you.
You're both playing Home Bake in a couple of weeks.
Yep.
And is it a church? When's the next significant church anniversary?
The church have had their anniversary. That was the Opera House.
Last year?
No, this year.
This year.
Yeah, it's actually our 31st year, but we did it. What's a year when you've been going that long? So we did it. I remember when a year was everything. Yeah. A year would be the rise and fall of 100 bands. People who'd come and go. Now it's like, oh, yeah, I can't even remember when that was. So we did the Opera House with the orchestra.
That's
but
right.
Now we're doing the Enmore Theatre in December.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
So the good ones just keep going.
So they say.
Apparently.
Well, it's been so lovely to catch up with you both. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And Great Australian Songbook comes out later this week. So I think it's going to be under a lot of Christmas trees.
Let's hope so, yeah.